Vayidaber Moshe ken, referring to when Moshe has talked to the Bnei Israel and to prepare them for going out, coming and telling them that he's coming to redeem them, and they didn't want to listen to him. It says Vayidaber Moshe ken, ולא שמעו אל משה מקוצר רוח ומעבודה קשה. They couldn't listen to, they didn't listen to him from קוצר רוח. קוצר רוח is being very impatient, or in our generation they call it anxiety, that you run out of your balance. It can come in many different ways, this anxiety. But nevertheless, קוצר רוח is really impatience. When somebody is very annoyed, I don't know if you ever had the opportunity to see somebody that is in a lot of pain, they're very edgy, very get upset very quick, because they snap, because they're in a lot of pain, and they're very uncomfortable, and they snap quick. This is kotzer ruach. But another way of explaining kotzer ruach is when somebody is under a lot of pressure, then they have anxieties, fear, worry, and many others. Another part, that they didn't listen to him, avodah kasha, from hard work. They worked very hard. And when you work all day long, you come home at 10 o'clock at night, you don't feel like dealing with anything. You just want to crash on the bed. And anybody who comes to talk to you will receive a harsh reaction. Nevertheless, Moshe Rabbeinu came to the Bnei Israel and didn't want to listen to him. ויש לדקדק לפי פירוש רשי ז"ל. We have to understand what Rashi explains here. שהקוצר רוח היה מחמת עבודה קשה. But the fact that they were very impatient was as a result from the hard work. אם כן, למה לכתוב רק מעבודה קשה? So if this is the case, then just write, they worked hard. Why are you writing that they didn't listen to Moshe from kotzer ruach, from being impatient, and from hard work, when Rashi says it's the impatience, the kotzer ruach, was as a result of the hard work. So just write, imken, lichtov rak ma'avodah kasha. So just write, avodah kasha, they just worked hard. Vegam, ma'avodah kasha mashmio, she'akotzer ruach haya mania bifnei atzmo. Also, we understand from that from as a result from the hard work, then the impatient was a problem between before itself. Va'avodah kasha bifnei atzmo. It seems more reasonable to say the impatient or the kotzer ruach was one thing, the avodah kasha was another thing. Ach ha'inyan al pi ma shedikdakti le'el. But to explain it based on what I have explained before, על קל וחומר שאמר משה רבנו עליו השלום, משה רבנו said קל וחומר. קל וחומר is so much more so. That if so and so is like this, so much more so is like that. משה רבנו said קל וחומר, הן בני ישראל לא שמעו, ואיך ישמעני? משה רבנו last week said, if you remember, he said to Hashem, if Bnei Israel didn't listen to me, how would Paro listen to me? If I come now to the Bnei Israel and I'm telling them, I'm your redeemer, I'm taking you out of exile, and they don't want to listen to me, so much more so, Kal Vachomer, the Paro is not going to listen to me. Excuse me? Yeah, needless of course. Of course, but how would Paro listen to me if Bnei Israel didn't listen to me? ועוד מה שאמר משה רבנו, משה רבנו also added, אני ערל שפתיים, I stutter, I can't speak well. Didn't Hashem already told him, הלא כבר אמר לו השם ידברך, מי עשו מילם? Didn't Hashem answer to me, who cares if you're a stutter? Who do you think makes a person a mute, and who do you think makes a person talk? Obviously Hashem is telling that to Moshe. Why are you worried about telling me you're a... Aral Svatayim, that you stutter. יש לברש דלא כפירוש רשי. We can explain it another way, not how Rashi explains it. באמת, מה שלא שמעו, היה מחמת שני דברים. The reason why Bnei Israel didn't listen, there was another two reasons. דעית הדברים היוצאים מן הלב נכנסים מן הלב. We know that when a person comes to talk to somebody, approaches somebody, and talks to them, and his words come out from his mouth, his words come out of his heart, then they penetrate into the heart. If you talk to somebody because of you just want to rebuke them, or you just wanted to show you better, or for many other reasons that is not for the right sake, then the words that you say will not be heard. But if your words come from your heart, meaning you care, and it's, you only said because that you care, then they will penetrate in the listener's heart. This is called דברים היוצאים מן הלב נכנסים אל הלב. Words that come out of the heart come into the heart. והנה יש שני מניעות מצד המקבל. Now if I really care about somebody and I talk to that person, whatever, doesn't matter right now if I inspire them, rebuke them, but I mean well and I really care about that person, then my words coming out of my heart. Now, the receiver, on the other hand, he will decide if he's receiving what I want to get, what I want to say or not. I mean, I can talk and talk and talk, and nothing will go in. So we know there are two things that will prevent the receiver to receive what I have to say. הנה יש שני מניעות מצד המקבל. שגם הדברים היוצאים מהלב אין נכנסים לליבו, דהיינו. That the receiver is controlling two factors, that he will either accept what I have to say or won't accept what I have to say. And I can talk as much as I want, but if the receiver doesn't want to receive, he's not going to get it. What are these two things? Aleph, im ha-shomea u'ish bli'al. The first is that the person is a sealed person, doesn't want to receive anything. The second, מצד הצוות, גם כן אין יכול לקבל דברי המוכיח. בליעל, the right translation for בליעל is a person that is not receptive, exactly. But the other part is that when a person is sad, is in עצבות, in sadness and depression, he also can't get receive what the person is telling him. And וזהו באמת שלא שמעו אל משה מקוצר רוח. This is really why they didn't listen to Moshe Rabbeinu from קוצר רוח, from being impatient, as it says in the Mishnah, שהיה ביניהם עובדי עבודה זרה. Some of the people between the Bnei Israel were idol worshippers. So some of the reasons why they didn't accept it, because they didn't want to accept Moshe Rabbeinu. They wanted to continue believing in their idols. ומעבודה קשה, from hard work, היינו מחמת עצבות. So the first reason why they didn't listen, we said that the reason is from somebody who's unreceptive. Here he's calling it that somebody his motion is directed to idol worship. So not necessarily bowing down to an idol, but that their entire belief is for something else but Hashem. So when you come and tell them your solution is the Torah, no. Another day, I spoke with somebody who told me a personal problem, and he asked me for advice. So I told him, do you put tefillin on? No. Do you eat kosher? No. Do you observe Shabbat? No. I said, okay, so why about you start with that and give that a good run for a couple months and then we'll talk again. I'm not interested in doing that. I said, okay, so why are you asking me? If you want to get an answer that will fit you, go and ask somebody else. If you're asking me, what did you think I'm going to tell you? To put a bathing suit and run on the beach? You contacted me, so you get an answer based on what the Torah will tell you. So you're going through A, B, and C, because you are not connected to your source. When you're not connected to your source, which is God, of course, then why are you expecting that you have short circuits? Like, well, what do you think you're going to hear from me? I'm going to tell you to rent now 50 movies and a bag of popcorn and to watch movies all day long. Like, what answer were you expecting to hear from me when you contacted me? No, but I don't want to do, I don't believe in that. So if you don't believe in that, then you have to call somebody else. Don't call me. But nevertheless, I told him, listen, if you put your soul on a diet and you don't let your soul eat and drink, which the soul doesn't eat food, it eats Torah and it breathes Torah. So if you're going to put your body on a diet now, you forget about a diet. You're going to deprive your body from food. So in the first couple of hours, you'll be just uncomfortable. After that, you'll get a stomach ache. After that, you'll get a headache. After that, you'll become nauseous. A day will pass, you'll become weak. At some point, you're going to collapse. So you can go maybe 3-4 days without food, but how many hours can you go without air? Maybe a minute or two. So now you're clogging all the paths of air and food to your neshama, and then you are surprised that your neshama is reacting. So whatever you feel there, doesn't matter, pain, sadness, depression, anxiety, fear, what do you think coming from? Your soul, you're choking your soul. So your soul is reacting. Give your soul what it needs. I'm not telling you to become now the chief rabbi of the world. Just give your soul a little bit of air. Put filling on every day. What does it take you? 10 minutes. If you eat kosher, what's the big deal? So you just don't eat whatever you want. And okay, I know it's not easy, but nevertheless, I told him, if you choke your neshama, it will suffer. So his approach was, no, but I don't believe in these things that you're telling me. So I said, okay, so I can't really help you. Because you asked me why you have these issues, and I'm answering why you have these issues. He, not that he wasn't receptive, the angle of what he was looking at can be called as idol worship, because he doesn't believe in God. He wanted me to maybe give him some hocus pocus, or maybe subscribe a pill. I don't know what he was expecting. So this is in one way can be described as idol worship. Why? Because you don't believe in God. I told you, put filin on, eat kosher and keep Shabbat, observe Shabbat, it will solve your problems. Meaning that the salvation, the answer comes from God. He says, I don't believe in this. Okay, if you don't believe in this, then so I can't help you. But this is the first level of being not receptive, that the mind is not directed at Hashem. If I believe Hashem can be my savior, then he will save me. Then I will read my Tehillim, go and pray, go and eat kosher, whatever it is, I will do to reach my salvation, my redemption, my health, whatever it is. But I somebody now has a problem, he goes to his rabbi, rabbi tells him, okay, read 10 chapters of Tehillim. Oh, okay, I will. That's the answer, rabbi? Okay, I'll read them. No, we do this mitzvah, then do that mitzvah. When you don't want to accept what the Torah tells you, so in another way, you can be defined as idol worship. Because you think your help, your salvation, your solution will come from somewhere else. That was one reason why they didn't receive what Moshe has to say, because they were idol worshippers. They said, we don't want to serve God. Because what did Moshe tell them? I'm going to take you out of Mitzrayim. We're going to go to Har Sinai. You're going to get the Torah and you're going to start serving God. Oh, no, now you're telling us to serve God? That's not for us. Yeah, no. We'd rather stay here. Don't come now and bother us with your tzitzis and your tefillin and Shabbat and kosher. You're out of your mind. So they didn't want to hear Moshe Rabbeinu. The next, that they were so overworked, brought them into depression. So that's why I said so many times, nothing's changed in our generation from 3,400 years ago. The only thing that is different is that we have iPhones, but nothing changed really. Some of them were sunk into idol worship, and our generation also, half of us, whether you acknowledge it or not, we also practice idol worship. If you clean your car 17 times a day, that's idol worship. You're idling your car. And if you work 18 hours a day to get more money, then you You're idling your money. I mean, your money becomes, you're worshiping your money. Now it can come in severe things and small things. I mean, I think that the people that all day long are also on the phone, there's also some type of a form of idolatry. All day long, you just leave the phone for 10 minutes, so you have to be all day long on the phone. Now, it's not that I'm bowing down to the phone, but it's in our generation, they don't want to call something idol worship. It sounds very serious. They'll say addiction. What's the difference between an addiction and worshiping something? So, of course, again, not going to get into the whole issue with addiction. Sometimes it's physical, sometimes it's emotional. But nevertheless, we also have this problem of idol worship, and we worship certain things. Now, another problem that we have in our generation that they have too is depression. I mean, it's sad to say, and people don't like hearing it, but the majority of the world are depressed. I would say easily 80% of the world are depressed. Now, some, it's extreme, to a point that it's already had to be dealt with chemicals, which don't do much, by the way. They make the person more messed up, more depressed, more confused, more sick. This is just a way to numb the world. But nevertheless, most of the people in the world are depressed. And it's coming from many different places. Either it will come from the form of idol worship, because if I don't get what I want, then it puts me under depression. But nevertheless, we're not going to start dissecting now the reason why, but the majority of the world is depressed. It's very hard to find very cheerful and strong-minded, happy people that they're just happy that they're breathing. Most people are like, ugh. You know, like, so same idea. That's what they had in Mitzrayim. They were, part of them were idol worshippers, and the majority of them were depressed. How can you not be depressed? You have a baby that gets thrown into the water. You work 18 hours a day. You can't be with your wife. You can't do this. You can't do that. You're oppressed. You become depressed. So the two reasons that it was saying, Kotzer ruach v'avodah kasha. So one of them, they just didn't want to listen to Moshe Rabbeinu saying, listen, with all the respect to you, Moshe, I don't want to put no tefillin. I don't want to observe Shabbat right now. I don't want to be dressed modest. I don't want to. That's exactly what we have in our generation. Go to many people, tell them, your problems are because you don't observe it. No, I'm saying, you go to some...
Why do they react like that?
Because this is a fine line of idolatry. That I don't want to believe in God. I want to believe in everything that has to do in this world. I don't want to believe that with my hard work I will go out of my depression. I want to believe in the pill. I don't want to believe that the society is governing me the right thing. I want to believe that what society is telling me is right. I don't want to believe in what God is telling me is right. So in a certain form, this is idolatry. Because I don't want to say the Torah comes and tells you, eat kosher. It will probably solve a lot of your emotional problems. But now the meat and the dairy and the this and the cooking and the this and the, leave me alone. I'd rather just eat whatever I want. Because society will tell you, no, the food is good. Everything that you take from the shelves is good. And people fall for that deception. 99% of people in the world, they believe everything that it says on the product. Go now into a supermarket, 99% of the products in the supermarket are garbage. It's not even food. And people believe it because it says all natural. 100% natural, no sugar added. And people fall for that. So come now to a person and tell him, you know that in this product, it's all junk? No. You're crazy. No, I'm not crazy. Everything in this product is junk. It's not food. So this is the same idea. Come to a person, tell now, this is the truth. This is the Torah. That's the truth. No, I don't believe that. I believe in this. This is a form of idolatry.
Now, in themselves.
Yeah.
I believe in myself.
They believe in themselves. They believe in what society is telling them to believe in. I mean, right now, most of the people are hypnotized by society or mainly by the governments that are hypnotizing everybody. Not like with a clock like that, but the governments are grabbing everybody by their sensitive area. And everybody falls for that. And then you have this small percentage that say, I don't believe that. That's not true. And these people are perceived as cuckoos because they're not going mainstream. Same thing here. Now, this is what I'm saying so many times over and over. Nothing changed for 3,400 years. Moshe Rabbeinu came to Mitzrayim and told them, Chevre, God talked to me. Let's become observant. Ah! Now, telling me to observe Shabbat. Go now to, I don't know where, I don't want to say a name of a city, so it won't be Lashon Hara about the city. But just for the sake of the thing, go to Tel Aviv now. Stand in the middle of the street and start screaming, Chevre, in 2 days is Shabbat. Huh? People, get out of here. Hey, lady, why don't you cover yourself? So, same idea. Yeah, Moshe Rabbeinu came and says, hey, guys, let's go out of Mitzrayim, and we're going to get the Torah, and we're going to be observant, and we're going to serve God. No, you must be kidding, right? You don't have anything else. Maybe just take us to Mexico. Let's just lie on the beach all day long. We'll go out with you. But you're telling us to go to the mountain now and get the Torah and now become now observant, become Jewish. No. Thank you so much. We'll stay here. So same here. Nothing changed. And like I told you, the next thing was the depression. They just couldn't take the situation. They were just very, very depressed. If you don't mind, let me just finish the paragraph. Then we'll do the questions and the comments. But nevertheless, so we said they had the form of idol worship, idolatry, and sadness, the depression. But there's a separation between these two. Idol worship is idol worship, and depression is depression. It's two different things. If the first part is preventing you from receiving what Moshe Rabbeinu had to say because you are an idolater, then, azay gam tzadik gamur yedaber dvarav, af al pi chen lo yekabel. Even if a complete tzadik will talk to you, you're not going to even to listen to that. Because your mind is, my mind is not on the Torah. My mind is there. So it doesn't matter who talks to you. Doesn't matter if you talk or I talk or the biggest tzadik of the generation who come, will tell him, come and put tefillin on. Aval im ha-meniyah im mitzad ha-tzvut, but with the prevention of listening to Moshe Rabbeinu was depression, but if it's coming from depression, then when the tzaddik gamur comes and talks to you and it comes from his heart, that will penetrate into the heart. Moshe Rabbeinu alav shalom, hen bnei Israel. Moshe Rabbeinu says, also bnei Israel didn't listen to me. Hayat toleh chisaron be'atzmo. Moshe Rabbeinu says, the problem is not in bnei Israel. The problem is in me. I don't know how to give over the message the right way. Because if I was 100%, Moshe Rabbeinu saying, then I will be able to convince them. Mechemat she'enot tzadik gamur. Moshe Rabbeinu was so humble. He says, ani tzadik? I'm a tzadik? Ma pitom? I'm a shepherd. Lachen hem nechlesim dvarav bo'oznehem. That's why he felt that his words don't go into their ears. Because he felt that he's not a tzadik. He thought that it's because they're sad, mechamat tzvutam. And then he also said, v'zeo v'anir al zvataim. My words, not that Moshe Rabbeinu says I'm stuttering. He just says my lips are not moving the right way to explain the reality how it is. He didn't hold himself as a tzadik gemur. Rotze lomar she'eni tzadik gemur, ve'ech yishmeni paro. If Bnei Israel can't listen to me, how can I go fight the klipa right now? If I can't go now to another individual and convince him to do a mitzvah means that I'm not in that level that my words are being heard. How will I go now and fight the klipa? Sheminiyato mitzad shu ish blial venimtza olek akol kahogen. Basically saying that Moshe Rabbeinu saying I'm not in that level. Then how would Paro listen to me that he's for sure an idol worshiper? So, we'll continue the rest. I mean, the second mamar is pretty connected to that. We'll continue that tomorrow, Bezrat Hashem. But at least to take something from today is that we have to understand that really nothing changed for 3,000 years. They were in Mitzrayim, we are in Mitzrayim. Our Mitzrayim is our state of limitation. And they also had the same idea. Just the difference between them and us, that they had a revealed Redeemer that came and says, I'm going to redeem you. We are a little bit more upgraded because we're already going by our history. when our Mashiach is going to come, it's going to be very obvious. There's not going to be any questions. We're just going to go. The point is that we have to make now our Redeemer appear. And we have to understand that there are two things that are stopping us from getting there. A is this fine line of idolatry, that I give all the credit to everything else but Hashem. I need to give all the credit to Hashem, and everything else is secondary. Now, I know I always make fun of the phones and this and that. There's nothing wrong with all these things. God gave us this technology to better our life. So if I take the phone because I want to spread Torah with it by blasting a message on WhatsApp or whatever it is, then I'm using the technology for something positive. If I want to do a Shiur Torah live, I'm taking this technology and I'm using it to Hashem. If I can now do what is so many things to do, there's apps with Torah on them. I can learn Torah on the phone. So anything can be transformed from good to bad. This is, we spoke about it a couple of times, is the secret of the tree of knowledge. There is mixed good and bad in it. Anything in the world, I can utilize it for something positive and for something negative. I choose what to do with it. The problem is that since I am stuck in Mitzrayim, then I fall for the temptation of the world, and instead of elevating something, I fall into it. I need to just know how everything is controlled by the Kadosh Baruch Hu, and to give all the credit only to Hashem. That's why you see now the Bemet Baruch Hashem, a little bit of society, are starting to understand that, wait a minute, the real deal is what Hashem gives us, and all the rest is fake. So you see that now, Baruch Hashem, there's much more awareness for the right way of eating, because that's what Hashem gave me. Hashem gave me an orange. He didn't give me some processed food that went through some lab, and it's just coming in a nicer way, and it's packaged much nicer, and it's easy just to go, instead of getting my hands dirty with soil now, why don't I get my hands dirty now to put my hand in a tree? You're out of your mind. My manicure now is going to affect my hand. So, but you see that people are seeing the sheker and the emet. The emet, the truth, is what Hashem gave me. Hashem gave me, that's the truth. And anything that we distort, that's what we distort, and that's the sheker. It can come in nutrition, and it can come in many other things. That you see, Baruch Hashem, suddenly people are starting to come to their senses. Hashem didn't give me the option to create energy specifically from what the land produces. So people are drilling into the land, getting all sorts of oil and gases, and of course, I'm not saying it's not working, but that's not Hashem's intention. Excuse me?
It's very bad to do that.
It's very bad.
He gave us solar power.
Exactly. Hashem gave us the sun. That's the source of energy. And when Mashiach is going to come, the Lubavitcher Rebbe said, when Mashiach is going to come, all our energy is going to be solar. We're not going to have such a thing as power plants and pollution and all this drilling into the ground. There's a reason why there's oil in there. It's not for us to take it out.
Right.
So it's to, so to say, to lubricate the layers of the earth. So with the movements, nothing happens. Now there's no oil. There's no, so to say, lubrication. The plates are hitting each other in the wrong way. It's causing all these earthquakes and volcanoes. It's not normal. So I'm not going to get into this whole thing, but the point is that Hashem says, I gave you the sun. The sun is a source of energy. And now you see that people are starting to develop, not only the sun. You can use the wind as energy. You can use currents as energy. Now they're developing energy sources from the currents of waves. The waves are going in and out, and this is very powerful. You know how powerful the waves are? So you can create energy like that. So you see that people are starting to come to their senses. You see, that's another a proof that Mashiach is coming, where we're starting to see the emet. This is the truth. This is not the truth. So we have to go out of this state of limitation. A, to accept that whatever Hashem gives us, that is the truth. But more than that, then unfortunately, many people do fall for the trap of the depression, of the sadness. This is also type. Why does it say that their sadness was because of the Avodah Kasha? Because the sadness is coming also from a very fine place of idolatry. What, you don't believe that this is what Hashem intended to you? That you have to fall into depression? Now, I know it's a very sensitive subject. A lot of people get very touchy and upset. How are you talking about that? You don't know where the depression is coming from. You've never been depressed. You don't know. I know what I'm talking about. The depression is a form of a spiritual way to hook you, to get you away from Hashem. And where it's coming from, you can blame it on many things. You can blame it on the fact that you lost your house. You can blame it on the fact that you got divorced. You can blame it on a million and one things. You can blame it that you don't have money, this is not working out, that is not working out. This is just an excuse. The depression is coming from a much, much more deeper place. And mainly become from the neshama. If the neshama is depressed, so the person will be depressed. And most people are putting their souls on a diet. So the soul is depressed, so it will manifest into the body. I know many people that they don't have a dime and they're happy. I know many people that they have the biggest tzarot in the world. All the this headache, and they're, I mean, I'm not saying that they're jumping up and down, but they don't carry this heaviness. This is coming specifically from the soul. The teachings of Kabbalah explains that our soul is built from four elements, and if the element of afar is becoming the most dominating one, the character trait of it is pulling the person down. And the person becomes heavy and sad and depressed, and this is only coming from the soul. Everything can be dealt with. But nevertheless, we'll continue Bezrat Hashem the Ma'amar tomorrow. We've got a little bit of an idea that I have to understand that my way of going out of Mitzrayim is that I have to be 100% devoted to Hashem. There's no, can't be any form of idolatry here. And again, the idolatry is not bowing to an idol. It's the fact that I believe that maybe something else is the truth beside Hashem. So this is another one type of a form of idolatry. And of course, the sadness. The sadness is only coming from the soul, which means that I have to nourish my soul. If my soul is not happy with the situation, means it's not getting enough nutrition. It means I have to pray. It means I have to learn Torah. It means I have to do mitzvot. I'm obviously missing things here. And I know a lot of people point fingers. What are you talking about? You don't even know what you're talking about. This is not depression. These are the type of people who say, no, I'd rather take the pill. And I'm not chas v'shalom putting anybody, I'm not joking, not making a joke of anything or trying to make fun of anybody. I'm just trying to address the situation. Because I know for a fact that the pills and anything else that society gives you, they don't do nothing. They numb the problem. It doesn't help the problem. It's just putting everybody under a sleeping pill. So doctors don't know how to deal with it. A person comes and says, I'm depressed, I have anxieties, I have fears. Here, take this one. It's a good one. It just came out. It's all about money and control. And it doesn't do anything. It doesn't. If it would cure somebody, I would vote for it. But you know how do we know that it doesn't do anything good? Because people don't get cured. If it would be so successful, then it would cure the person. Then the person would be like, that's it. I took my dose. I took my 10-day antibiotic and I'm healthy now. So that's where you know that it's failing. Because it doesn't cure anybody. If it would cure, we say, okay, I believe in it. It doesn't cure. Just puts you on a sleeping mode. And then after a couple months, just add the dosage or to change to a different type. Oh, try this one. It's just, they're basically frauding the world. The world is being frauded by that. And the reality, it doesn't really help.
Destroys.
Of course it destroys. It's same thing with any pill. Any pill, I don't see any pill that helps. And I had this argument with somebody and I told him there's no pill that helps with anything. What are you talking about? I take pills for blood pressure. And I said, and what does the pills do? Well, I don't have blood pressure. And I was like, and if you stop taking the pill, what's going to happen? Well, I can't. It's going to be dangerous. So the pill didn't do anything. It's just temporarily taking the blood pressure down. Now you're dependent on the pill. And then you take away the pill, the blood pressure will now be double. So did you help the blood pressure? No. So what good would it do? Yeah, I told him, so just eat celery, your blood pressure will go down. And it's going to be, a 1,000 times more cost effective. So you fall for that, what the doctor tells you. So on the surface, it shows you that the blood pressure is down. So what? What did you do about it? You didn't cure the problem. You numb the problem. So that's the fraud that the world falls for.
They're seeing the effect as being the cause.
Yeah?
The effect of the blood pressure, the depression, that's the cause. It's a chemical thing. So let's change that and then you're fixed.
Yeah.
When the source is actually spiritual, and if you go to the root and fix the actual cause, then you don't need it.
And 100%. Not only that, the proof is in the pudding. If you see that your person goes off the pill, and the symptom comes back and the problems come back, then what good is the pill?
By the way, agriculture does the same thing.
100%. Yeah.
As soon as they stop, nothing's going to grow there. Fixing the problem. So we need to get in harmony with Hashem, get rid of the sheker.
That's exactly what we need to do. We need to believe, this is idolatry, we need to believe that everything comes from Hashem. Do what Hashem tells you, you'll be fine. And I know, people don't want to hear it because it's hard. It's a lot of hard work and devotion and dedication. But the proof is, and I can tell you from my own experience, thousands and thousands of people, that you see the proof. You do what the Torah tells you and you'll be fine. And I know a lot of people say, yeah, but I'm observant and I'm still depressed. Nevertheless, that's a different discussion. Bezrat Hashem, we should merit to see with our own eyes the coming of our Redeemer, Moshe Rabbeinu, our Moshe Rabbeinu. Should happen very soon in our days. Bezrat Hashem will continue tomorrow. In the meantime, we should have a beautiful, blessed day.